James chapter 4. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time we can share together in your word. We thank you for this epistle that you inspired James to write. And it's just many benefits to us, Lord, in our faith, that delicate balance in understanding where works, where action is part of our relationship with you, not that works save us, but works end up being the evidence that we are saved. And we thank you for his careful instruction to us. We pray that by your Holy Spirit, you will move in our hearts tonight as we study through these verses. We love you and praise you together in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. I'm going to back up to where we left off last time I was with you, James chapter 4. I'm going to read verses 13 through 16. And then we'll take a look at verse 17, the last verse of chapter 4, separately. But verses 13 through 16, James writes, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor." Some translations say a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. So for you note takers, here's the first thing to recognize is that these verses here, James 4, 13 to 16, this passage is about the brevity and uncertainty of life. And last time we talked about this, but I just want to kind of get a running start into where we left off and just make mention of the fact that the brevity of life is a reality. We don't sometimes think of our own mortality, but the fact of the matter is that none of us is guaranteed tomorrow, that each of us only has right now. And that's why in James 4 and also in Psalm 78 and in 1 Peter 1, the Bible reminds us of the brevity of life using different analogies. Life is like a vapor or a mist right here in James 4:14. Life is like a passing breath. Psalm 78:39 says, "For he remembered that we were but flesh, a breath that passes away and does not come again." 1 Peter 1:24 reminds us that life is like withering grass. It says all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flower falls away. In the grand scheme of things, life is very short. Your life, my life, is like a drop of water in the ocean of eternity. I mean, in comparison to eternity, the little span that we've been given called life is very, very short. And so James is writing here reminding us first of the brevity, and then we'll just touch briefly on the uncertainty of life. And he reminds us in this passage that because life is short, this passage confronts us in two ways. Number one, it confronts us about the reality of death. Every single one of us has to be prepared to die. I don't care how old you are or young you are. I've said this before, I'll say it again. In my 32 years of ministry, I've done more funerals for people under the age of 40 than for people over the age of 40. Now that could be because the demographics of our congregation generally tend to lean on the younger side. But I'm just saying, in general, we're not guaranteed tomorrow. Life is short. None of us knows. You know, the Bible says all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God knows the number of our days. We don't. So we have to live recognizing that life is short, being prepared to die whenever that day might be. And the only way we can be prepared to die is in knowing Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. And so I hope you have that assurance. I hope that you know him as your Lord and Savior, so that whenever that day comes, you'll be ready to go. You'll be ready to meet your Creator. You'll be able to be welcomed into heaven. And the other thing that this passage confronts us with is not only the reality of death, but also just where we stand in general in our relationship with God. And because we have such a short time on earth, this is the only chance we've been given to get right with God. So, again, if you're not in a good place with God, don't think that you necessarily have tomorrow. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. I was speaking downtown in D.C. this past Sunday, and a man came up to me, and he regularly plays tennis, and he told me that this past week, playing tennis with his tennis partner, and his partner stumbled, fell, face planted, blood on the court, and he goes on over and he, you know, tries to help him up. The guy had died. Massive heart attack just right there on the tennis court. You just don't know. That guy woke up that morning thinking it was a day just like any other day, and he didn't go home to his family. So we have to take seriously the brevity of life and also the uncertainty of life, because in this passage here, James goes on to talk about how we can't be presumptuous. We can't be presumptuous about life. He actually says that it's evil to go around boasting. That's the way he ends verse 16. He says, in your arrogance, you're boasting. And he says, all such boasting is evil. And the boasting he's talking about there in the context is, hey, tomorrow, next year, 10 years from now, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to do the other thing. And he's saying, don't be so presumptuous about life. How about you change your wording to always defer to the will of God? So in other words, he's not saying we should never plan for tomorrow. We should. We should plan for tomorrow, but we should live for today. And we should recognize and not be presumptuous that we have next year or 5 years from now or 10 years from now. So live like there's always a tomorrow, but cherish each day and make sure that you prioritize your day for today, because we don't have the guarantee of tomorrow. And so he's saying, you know, people go around and go like, you know, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. He's like, that's a bit presumptuous. You ought to say, we're going to do this if it's the Lord's will. It may not be the Lord's will. And so don't be presumptuous about life, because there's an uncertainty to life. You know, sometimes we get ahead of God. We get presumptuous with our plans. And that's what he's addressing here in chapter 4. He's like, you know, you're going around saying tomorrow, next year, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. Sometimes we get ahead of God. It happens. It's somewhat our human nature. We just can get driven with our ideas and ambitions and goals and desires. Nothing wrong with those things. But the problem is sometimes we get ahead of God in that we have all these grand plans, and then we ask God, you ever prayed something like this? God, you know, I'm going to move here, or I'm going to date her or him, or I'm going to take this job or that job. Would you please bless those things? And sometimes I think God's up in heaven with his arms crossed like, I didn't really lead you there, so why do you think I should bless you there? So we get ahead of God sometimes instead of learning the art of waiting. Just waiting on the Lord. Just seeking him and his guidance and his direction. Don't be presumptuous about what we're going to do. We need to make sure that we are always following the Lord's lead. Psalm 37:7 says, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Psalm 130 verse 5 says, I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. Verse after verse after verse of the Bible talks about waiting for the Lord. I've never once read a verse that says, hurry up! Because most of us are well in front of God, and then we expect him to bless our endeavors. Well, it doesn't work that way. How about if we seek the will of God or the face of God, and then as he leads and guides, we can expect that he will bless because he's out front. When instead most of us, which is what James is warning about, are presumptuous about our plans, out in front of God, wanting him to bless where we go and what we do and who we date and where we live. How about we learn to follow his lead? Well, verse 17, the end of chapter 4, verse 17 just simply says, therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Now, most of you might be aware of this, but just to put this point up on the screen for you, there are sins of commission and sins of omission. And I underline the word omission because that's what James 4:17 is really talking about. The kind of sin when we omit doing something that we should have done. So let me clarify the two so we understand, and I know most of you already do, but just to make sure we're all on the same page. A sin of commission is universally equal and applies to all of us. Lying, for example. If you commit the sin of lying, you're guilty. And that applies to all of us. If I lie, if you lie, we're guilty. If I steal or you steal, guilty. That's a sin of commission. It's an act. We've committed something as a sin. If we murder somebody, if envy, you know, you name it. If you commit a sin because of something you do that is wrong, that's a sin of commission. But sometimes we don't stop to realize that what James is saying here in James 4:17 is that there are also sins of omission, which is when you don't do what is right and you know you should do it, that's also sin. And that does not apply universally, that applies individually. Because what God might be calling you to do in regards to something that is specifically right and you don't do it, that's sin for you. That's not sin for me, that's sin for you. And this is where, when we get sensitive to the still small voice of the Lord and the leading of the Holy Spirit, that we are apt to commit sins of omission because we deny where the Lord is leading us, guiding us, or telling us what to do. You know, what if, just what if, I'm just as a random example, what if the Lord says to you, hey, bake a pound cake. You just intuitively, instinctively, you know, by the Spirit, no, bake a pound cake, take it to your boss and tell her God loves her. God, I'm not baking a pound cake for my boss. Are you kidding me? Maybe a fruit cake. You know, my boss is a fruit cake, but I'm not baking a pound cake. And you argue with God. You're like, I'm not doing that. Again, it's a simple thing, but just what if? In the still small ways that God deals with our hearts, I want you to do this, I want you to do that. And we're like, I'm not doing that. You know what is right to do it, and you don't do it. That's sin. That's between you and God, but God takes record of it, and he knows it is sin. A few months ago, Terry and I were having dinner at Cracker Barrel in Sterling, just because my cholesterol's a little low, you know, and so I, you know, need to raise my cholesterol numbers a little bit, and besides, I love eating under rusty farm equipment. And anyway, but I love Cracker Barrel, to be honest with you. I love Cracker Barrel, and somebody had given us a gift card to Cracker Barrel, so you know, I love Cracker Barrel, and we have a gift card, like double bonus, right? And so we're having dinner. My wife doesn't even know this, so she's finding out tonight. And so we're having dinner, and we had the gift card, and dinner's over. And I noticed, so I'm, you know, Terry's sitting across from me, and I noticed across my wife's shoulder this elderly lady eating all alone. And if there's one thing that my heart aches for in any restaurant is when I see people eating alone. And so dinner was over, and I felt the nudge of the Holy Spirit, give that lady your gift card. And I'm like, nah. You know, that is the devil talking to me right now, you know. Get thee behind me, Satan, you know. And so give the lady the gift card. I'm like, nah. She'll probably say no. You know, she will probably say, I don't even know you. This isn't probably a real gift card, you know. It's going on in my head. So dinner's over, and so we get up from the table. And you know at Cracker Barrel how they have that great country store. So where do you think my wife headed, right? So we finished dinner, I've got the, you know, the bill, the check. She heads to the little country store, and I just can't get away from it. It's like, you know, nagging me. So I walk over to that lady's table, and I said, hi, excuse me. I'd just like to give you this gift card and tell you that God loves you. And she looked at me, and tears started to well up in her eyes. And she said, you have no idea how I needed to hear that, even more than the gift card. So I think to myself, well, great, then you don't need the gift card. You know, just you just needed a word of encouragement. But I had it out, and so she, you know, she's like, thank you so much. I'm like, you're welcome. No, I didn't do that. I let her have it, because I was just so blessed by the way that she was so touched by it. And let me tell you something, if I had walked out of that store, that would have been sin for me. Because I know at times, you know at times, when the Lord is dealing with you in a personal way, and if you don't do what is right, it's a sin of omission. So don't think to yourself, well, I didn't actually do something bad, so therefore I'm not guilty of sin, because sin is not only doing what is wrong, but sin is also not doing what is right when you know the right thing to do. Into chapter 5, he says, "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded, and their corrosion will be a witness against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up treasure in the last days. Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of Sabbath. You have lived on the earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the just. He does not resist you." So James has some harsh things to say here about those who are wealthy. Now, please, we got to always take Scripture in context and balance Scripture in the full counsel of Scripture. Deuteronomy 8:18 says it is God who gives you the ability to produce wealth. So it isn't that God is condemning those who are wealthy universally, because God's the one who gives someone the ability to make wealth. He is here condemning the wealthy particularly. What do I mean? Not universally. It's not a broad brush. He is condemning in particular the wealthy who rely on their wealth instead of God, people who put their security in their money instead of the Lord, people who value the material over the spiritual, and then on top of it, who he says here, who use their money to oppress or mistreat others. This is why he says there in verse 4, how he talks about how they have defrauded their employees by not paying them the wages that they are due. In other words, these folks here that he's calling out are greedy. They're not generous, they're greedy, and they are using their wealth to defraud, to rob people, to mistreat, and to oppress others. Now, that said, so that we understand, this is not just, hey, everybody who's wealthy, you're doomed and you're evil. That's not what he's saying here. He's talking specifically, particularly, about those who rely on their material things rather than rely on the Lord, who worship the almighty dollar instead of almighty God, who are beholden to material things rather than to the things of the Lord. That said, riches do present an additional and significant obstacle to the kingdom. Jesus said in Matthew 19, 23 and 24, then Jesus said to his disciples, he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again, I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." Now, he's talking there specifically about the potential problem of riches, of wealth. You see, having plenty can lead to an independence from God and result in self-sufficiency. The potential. Whereas having little to nothing will naturally sometimes, when someone is, where is my next meal coming from and where's the rent money coming from, it can create a dependence on God and a God sufficiency rather than a self-sufficiency. Not always. In the same way that not every wealthy person becomes self-sufficient, not every poor person turns to God. But the reality is that sometimes material things can create in us this sense of, I'm fine, I don't need God. I think this is why the writer of Proverbs 30, verses 8 and 9 says, "Give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of my God." It's almost like the best place to be is the middle class. But that said, whether wealthy or whether impoverished, the bottom line is here, be dependent on God. Whether you have much or whether you have little, be dependent on God. May He be Lord of your life, not your stuff. There's not a problem in having stuff. The problem is when your stuff has you. That's the challenge. That's the warning here. And Paul would summarize it this way Because he knew both ends of the spectrum. He would write in Philippians 4, 11 to 13, I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me the strength. See, he understood whether I have a lot or whether I have a little, my dependence is on the Lord. My source is the Lord. The object of my affection is not my stuff. It's my Savior. So we're going to pause it there, because in the last part of chapter 5, he gives 7 exhortations. We'll unpack those next time. But for tonight, I'm getting the thumbs up. So we're going to have baptisms this evening. So let's pause here and pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the reminder that whether well-fed or hungry, whether we have plenty or we are in need, you are the source of everything. And our affection is on you, Lord. And our dependence is on you. Forgive us when we are self-sufficient. May we be God-sufficient, God-dependent. When we always look to you, Lord, and we praise you and thank you together for this time in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen.